It's a very chilly welcome to you for this edition of Gower's Cricket Monthly. We're at Hove, where Sussex are taking on the Indians as the tourists prepare for their international summer. Let's now see what else we've got in store for you this month.
First, we look forward to the prospect of some entertaining cricket, with the Indians here for the first half of the summer. We've talked to Brian Lara and Richie Richardson, albeit on different lines. Angus Fraser has sneaked the video camera into Lords for some sights seldom seen before. Fiona Stevenson paints the portraits of three cricketing artists. And we've a report on Scotland's ambitions to qualify for the next World Cup.
Euro 96 might be coming up soon, but this definitely isn't that. In fact, the one-day internationals between England and India start in a couple of days' time at the Oval. India were the first side to tour this country after the war, so let's look back now at some of the more thrilling encounters between England and India since then.
The Nawab won the toss and decided to bat on a drying wicket. The tourists had been doing well against the counties, but an English newcomer to Test cricket, Alec Bedser of Surrey, was right on top and created something of a sensation by taking 7 for 49. Hardstaff was the hero of England's first knock. Defying Amanath and the rest of the attack, he scored 205 not out.
At 3 o'clock this afternoon, England won the first Test match, which at one time looked like staggering no further than last Saturday. That it did last was due entirely to the Indian skipper, Pataudi.
It's a lovely hit. It's straight down the ground.
And that's gone through for four, and that's his 100. Pataudi, 6 Test 100.
There's a really fine wicket-keeping catch, and look at the elation from Geoff Arnold. It's one of the best shots he's played. It was shortish, but I know a few players who might have been playing it straight back down the pitch.
Be another, yes, a magnificent hook shot. Six times he's found the boundary.
There it is, tip and run. Vensaka has made another 100. It's as good a stroke as he's played. Don't bother looking for that, let alone chasing it. It's gone up into the building works. Yeah. 300 for Graham Gooch.
Well, the man you saw there suffering from the weight of Graham Gooch's bat is with me now, Ravi Shastri, the former Indian all-rounder, who I'm delighted to say is going to join us in the BBC commentary box this summer. Now, to give you credit, Ravi, during that series in 1990, you did also score a couple of hundreds, so you must have one or two happy memories as well.
Yes, because it was my first 100 in England ever. It was the test match at Lord's. The wicket was good, not because Graham got 300, but it was a good track, and the weather was very good in that second half. And yes, happy memories.
I also remember actually at the Oval in that 100 there, we woke you up with a pretty sharp smack on the head, didn't we?
Yes, but that was a very good wicket. That the Oval wicket had a bit of bounce. The ball came onto the bat. It was much quicker than some of the other wickets we had played on, and outfield was good, and you were in good nick, so I enjoyed that 100 too.
Well, I enjoyed mine there as well. Anyway, you're now turned full-time commentator and analyst, so let's have a look at this current Indian side. Let's start with the captain, Mohammad Azharuddin. He's been under a lot of pressure, especially after that semi-final loss in the World Cup. Problems with his personal life, has he put all that behind him?
I think he would. He's a professional cricketer, and he's been there long enough. He had a wonderful series in 1990, and I'd like to think he'd like to carry on from there, because he's a very important man for the Indian team. If he gets going, then I think the confidence would rub off on the other players.
Yeah, he's a wonderful stroke maker, but how good a captain do you think he is?
Well, he's had a very good record, but one mustn't forget that he's captained most of his matches in home conditions on wickets that have been turners, so this will be a true test for him.
Now, he's got a couple of players he's going to rely on heavily. First of all, Sachin Tendulkar, who is a wonderful batsman. How good is he?
Well, arguably the best batsman in world cricket at the moment. He's batted wonderfully over the last couple of seasons, and I think India rely very heavily on him. They depend, in fact, at times too much on him. I hope the pressure doesn't get to him, because if he gets going and is in full flow, I think the spectators in England will really enjoy his batting.
But so far, he seems to have actually a very good temperament. He seems to cope with it all pretty well.
Well, he's 22 or 23, but he's a very level-headed guy. He's got all the success at a very young age, but he's coped up with it very well, especially in India, where you play in front of large crowds. He's a national hero. But it doesn't affect him. He just goes out there game after game and delivers.
He's a very lucky young man. Now, the other man that we know quite a bit about in this country following his summer here last year for Northants is Anil Kumble, who bowled very well, took over 100 wickets in the championship. He's also an important man.
Very important man, but one mustn't forget he was a bit of an unknown quantity when he came last summer, and he picked up 100 wickets, bowled beautifully, and has been our most consistent bowler in the last 2 years. But I think the pressure will show on him in the series, because it's the first half, it's cold, and he'll need conditions that are a lot warmer to grip the ball.
OK, so those are the three we know something about. There are a lot of young players, new players in this side. So with your help now, let's go and have a look at some of the players that we don't know so much about.
The Indians will have to do all the stretching, because the weather here at the moment is totally different from the weather prevailing in India. Sandeep Patil will have a tough job on his hands to emulate the successful Ajit Wadekar.
Mandrekar's 50.
Sanjay Mandrekar has had a checkered career after a bright start, but everybody knows his potential. He's a fine player, and India would be looking to him to fire at the top of the order. Navjot Sidhu has been one of the pillars of the Indian batting over the last couple of seasons. An experienced opener, has been in the game for over a decade now, and he would like to improve his performance here. Vikram Rathore, who plays for Punjab in the Ranji Trophy, got a lot of runs last season in domestic cricket, had a very successful series against the England A team as well, and already in England has made a good impression. A very promising cricketer with a good cricketing brain. Ajay Jadeja has played a very important role in India's success in one-day cricket in the last 6 or 8 months. Very powerful hitter lower down in the order and a magnificent fielder. and a chirpy character at the same time. He'd like to improve his test match performance. Sunil Joshi had a great season in domestic cricket last year for Karnataka. The only player to take over 50 wickets and score over 500 runs. And even though the conditions here are not ideal, still a very promising cricketer. But I think two players who have a very important role to play for India are Javagal Srinath and Anil Kumble. Both know English conditions well, and if Srinath picks up early wickets, then the Indians do have a chance.
Well, that's Ravi's roundup of the Indian tourists. With me now is their captain, Mohammad Azharuddin. As a welcome back again, it's your third tour of England, plus your stints at Derbyshire. What are you hoping for this time?
Well, yeah, I think I'm hoping to really do well at the beginning of the season, because the first time I came here was in the beginning of the season, in May, June and July. But the last time we came in 1990, we came in the second half of the tour, which was like the wickets were different, you know, the way, I mean, you played in that game, you played in that series, so it was totally different. But we've got a very young side now, because we've had a lot of changes after the World Cup. It's been a lot of hard work in the last 3 or 4 months. It's not been very good, but we're hoping to improve upon that.
Now, you're going to have to rely a certain amount on your more experienced players, and your better players like Sachin Tendulkar. How much responsibility lies with him now?
Well, that's right, yeah, and he's a main player now, because he's done so well over the years. You know, it's been only 7-8 years since he's been in the side,
but and he's still he's
really
young.
I mean, yeah, he's really hanging on, and I think he's not lost any enthusiasm, and he's really played well. He's our key player.
Now, it looks as though your batting lineup is somewhat stronger than the bowling. Are you worried when it comes to the Test matches that you might have problems bowling England out twice?
Well, it depends really on the wicket, you know. But we've got a side, we've got a lot of spinners, but I mean, spin has always been our main weapon over the years. So I think we're hoping to, I mean, make sure that our spinners bowl well on the in the beginning of the tour. And I know it's a little bit difficult with cold, you know, the wickets are different. But if they can bowl to a good line and length, they can be very lethal.
In a way, you'd have preferred actually to have been the second side on tour again, like you were last time.
Well, yeah, hopefully, yes. But anyway, I mean, I have no complaints.
And how confident are you can do well over here?
Well, yeah, I'm pretty confident, because you've got to be positive in your mind. I know we've had a very bad run in the last couple of months, but just have to forget and look ahead.
Well, being positive and forgetting some of the players who featured in this winter's disappointments, England have picked a squad for the one-day internationals, including 3 new faces and 2 men recalled. Here's Geoff Boycott with his assessment of that squad.
After England's poor one-day performances against South Africa in South Africa, and then their moderate performances in the World Cup, it was no surprise that there were going to be 1 or 2 changes. I think all in all, Phil de Freitas and Craig White of Yorkshire can think themselves unlucky, but basically it's a nice blend of experience and 1 or 2 new faces. Well, I'm pleased that Maynard's got another opportunity. In 94 he went to West Indies, didn't perhaps do himself full justice, but it wasn't always his fault. So little cricket in between the one-dayers and the test matches that if you didn't make runs and stay in the side, you were struggling A to get into form, and B, when you did get back into the team, to make runs. So he's a good player, and it may be a last opportunity for him, but I'm glad he's got one. Chris Lewis is the enigma of English cricket. A brilliant cricketer, fine athletic fielder, excellent pace bowler, and a good late-order hard-hitting batsman. So why isn't he being in the England team all the time? He's been in and out, he's had chances. Sometimes he's surprised us and played exceptionally well. Then other times he's let himself down and all his supporters. So this is another opportunity. But how many times can you have chances and opportunities, Chris? Chris has to decide that this may be the last chance. I hope he takes it. So come on, Chris, don't let yourself down and don't let the rest of us. You can do it, you have the talent, and he'll be a big plus for England if he stays in the side, not just in the Texaco one-dayers, but all season. Of the 3 newcomers, Ali Brown of Surrey is the most interesting. He'll open the batting with Michael Atherton, and they're probably going to say to him, play a few shots in the first 15 overs, try and play a little bit like the Sri Lankan Jayasuriya, who had a great World Cup. It's not going to be easy, that, because the pitchers here in England probably do a little bit more off the seam early on with the new ball than they did in the World Cup in India and Pakistan, so I wish him well. Young Irani of Essex, the all-rounder, well, he's a very tall lad. His outlook is aggressive, competitive. He'll bring a big uplift to the squad. He's a hard-hitting batsman. His bowling's not bad, But I think what he'll do, he'll give a bit of character lift to everybody. And then Alan Helam's boy at Kent, I think he's a very fine cricketer. Brilliant fielder, useful medium pacer who looks fairly innocuous, but he skids on at you. And I think he could be a very successful player in one-day cricket if he gets chances, not just this year, but against Pakistan later on, and probably next year as well too, when they're looking for players for the World Cup in 3 years' time. Well, with one or two new faces in the side, the team should be much more mobile in the field. That does need improving from what we saw in the World Cup. I think David Lloyd will play a big influence. He's got to lift the team up because the heads were down in the World Cup. A lot of players gave the impression that they wanted to go home rather than play cricket. I think all in all, we want to see an enthusiastic display, a positive display, good feeling, and I expect England to win.
And I hope they do. You can see highlights of all three one-day internationals here on BBC Television. The first of those highlights at 8 p.m. on Thursday on BBC Two. Tickets are still available for the second of those matches at Headingley on Saturday. And if you want to go, the ticket line is open on 0113 278 7394. Last year's Birmingham pitch produced a 2.5-day test and some painful times for England's batsmen. Today, pitch inspector Harry Brind, unhappy with the uneven grass covering on the pitch intended for this year's match, has told Warwickshire to use the reserve strip instead. All this year's test matches will be shown exclusively live on BBC Television, starting with that match at Birmingham on June the 6th. With those test matches in mind, as we've already heard, one man of whom much is expected is India's Sachin Tendulkar. He'll be a very happy man indeed if he can emulate the feats of last year's star tourist Brian Lara, who made over 700 runs in the series. Since then, though, it's been a bit of a topsy-turvy time for Lara, apparently weary of playing and having to settle a dispute with his own West Indies board. So what is the frame of mind at the moment? Well, he was back at Edgbaston again last week, and we went to find out about the current life of Brian.
Shot. Beautiful strike.
You know, things have been a bit shaky off the field, and of course I'll have to do some brushing up on that. But, you know, for me, as far as I'm concerned, that, you know, life's full of experiences, and I don't regret any moment at all. It's just an experience. Is it good or is it a bad experience? The main thing is you're going to learn from it. And, you know, I think nobody's perfect. And everybody's got to go through some sort of bad time. I hopefully might have passed that period. I'm going to go on to better things.
Well, it's a marvellous improvised shot.
I don't think I was prepared for such a, you know, people focusing on myself 100%, you know, being scrutinised, being a celebrity in some sort of a way. And I didn't go to school for that sort of ending. But again, it's a learning experience. I think anybody who've excelled in whatever field comes under that sort of pressure would realise that, you know, it's not just cricket or it's not just a sport. You've got to be very careful on what you do off the cricket field as well.
Brian Lara has his 100.
You know, I've got my feelings about West Indies cricket, and being a key member of the team, I just, you know, you voice your opinion. Maybe not the way people like other individuals voice their opinion. You know, it's a very ticklish situation where, you know, you're playing against England and somehow you feel that, you know, we're not totally focused as a team. And of course, some sort of disagreement happened and, you know, that caused a bit of conflict. But that's all done and gone with. We went to the World Cup. We lost to Kenya. You know, again, another sad day in West Indies cricket. But we've just got to look forward. Yeah. It's not really nice being a member of the team that's lost for the first time in how many years. So I think the guys are a bit disappointed in that and looking forward to getting back up there and maybe not emulating what the guys in the past have done so emphatically. They've won matches, one series, 5-0. I don't think we're capable of doing that. But I think we are capable of being successful.
That's four.
Sure, I've stepped into your mind at some point in time where, you know, you find yourself in a situation and you tend to blame it on the captain or something like that. if you are the captain, then you know that the full responsibility is on you, and you tend to react it in a more responsible way. And I think that plays a very important part in my cricket. I try to stress as much as possible that they got to be focused mentally, they got to have the right attitude, and they got to be very confident. And sometimes when you reach a certain level and you have that confidence, people think you're very cocky. But it's people who are full of confidence in their ability and go out there. I mean, Viv Richards is a typical example. I mean, I would hate to be a bowler running up to bowl to him, because he just seemed to be in total control of everything.
What about that?
I mean, anybody running up to bowl to him, I feel that he's won that mental battle already. And, you know, I definitely looked at that part of his game and realized that, you know, he's got what it takes. And, you know, he's been a great influence in my life. And, you know, he still is. We play a lot of golf together. We talk together, you know, especially with this controversial period I'm going through. If there's one person who could advise me on it, it would be him.
Well, that is dead straight down the ground. And that's gone all the way.
I'd love to come back to Warwickshire and play cricket. If I was not to play with Warwickshire, I would like to go to one of those counties that, you know, up there, playing well, you know, winning a couple of trophies or a trophy every year. I think I'd like, you know, to go where you have some sort of part to play. And you've got young cricketers, maybe lack of confidence. You've got a county that's not doing well, and, you know, you can have an input. Because winning isn't everything. I think the professionals in England should try to make sure they enhance the talents of around them. I'm looking forward to coming back. You know, having another season like 1994 would be incredible. But just to come back and show my face and enjoy a summer, I think I'd be a lot more prepared for another summer than I was in 94. And, you know, that'd be great fun. I have a life outside of cricket, and you know, I do different things and try to stay away from it. But with my international career and playing county cricket, sometimes playing in the West Indies, it's almost like 10 months of the year. So people identify you at all times with cricket, and whenever I can get away, I would do anything at all, just to get away and do something different and to be somebody else, and come back. I do enjoy cricket. I do enjoy being Brian Lara, but, you know, you need that time and space away from it sometimes.
Now, Brighton and Hove are this close. I'm in Brighton, here, and in Hove, here. But as far as the relationship between Brian Lara and his former West Indies captain, Richie Richardson, is concerned, it's probably safe to say that they weren't so close. While Lara's career still has some way to run, Richardson has now retired from international cricket. And away from the cares and troubles of the captaincy, has now discovered a completely new environment in which to wield his bat. Simon Hughes reports.
That's swung away mightily by Richie Richardson. Six runs.
On international cricket's roller coaster, you can be cruising one day, derailed the next. In the World Cup, the West Indies wheels completely flew off against Kenya. About that time, Richie Richardson was deciding to trade the vagaries of being captain of his country for attempted anonymity at Lashing CC, a Kent village team where there are no enthusiastic lackeys to carry your bag, fitness is a dirty word, and ownership of bat and pads is far more important than actual ability if you want to go in first.
Well, can you explain what you're doing?
Supposed to be playing cricket, supposed to be having a bit of fun. Something I've always wanted to do. I've played at the highest level for a very long time, worked really hard, 12 months a year, 7 days a week, and I think it's time now for me to relax, play a bit of cricket, enjoy myself. I've always wanted to play close to London, because I've never really explored London. I always wanted to be in this part of England. I've always been in the north of England. I've wanted to be down here, close to London, get involved with some business and so on. So it's more of my business interest than anything else.
Because you're doing some promotional work,
yeah,
as well.
Yeah, and other personal business that I'll be looking at as well.
Are you going to miss playing with the lads, the Kirtleys and the Courtneys?
No,
you're
not
be
really.
A bit of a relief in a way.
No,
perhaps.
Not really. I mean, I'll miss being in the company and so on, but actually playing, I don't think I'm going to miss it. You know, I've had a lot of cricket, and I'm looking forward to the next 50 years of my life.
So it's almost a sort of wind down in a way.
Yeah, most certainly, yeah.
Well, we're going to have a bat.
The side is recruited and captained by local entrepreneur David Fulb, a man who just loves giving orders.
It's all right, you're in the side, Richard. Oh, you made it, all right? Don't have to panic, all right? Don't have to panic, for God's sake.
Thank you very much. I'm more relaxed now.
Good, all right. All right, just for your cheat, you're one.
It's real village cricket. So he probably won't be accustomed to some of those cart tracks, but I think he'll be able to cope with them anyway. Plenty of small boundaries, plenty of sixes. Yeah, it'll be a cakewalk for him.
I've never had this, man. Yeah. I retired from international cricket and all the puppies in the world. What more can I ask for? Are you taking first strike, right?
Yeah, no, you're taking first
Good
strike.
Luck, buddy.
You're taking first strike.
All right, I'll go down this end, then.
Richardson has chosen his new stage wisely. Beautiful countryside, friendly bowling, and an opening partner who certainly won't steal the limelight.
Give it a month when all sort of the fuss has died down, and that's when it'll be good for, not just for Lashings, but a lot of local other clubs as well, because then they're going to get to see the real Richie Richardson. They won't have the press and the photographers all...
Oh, yes!
Takes it a six!
No!
Here's your bowler.
I know.
Excuse me, mate. Bowler's no.
Well, at this level, they're all pie throwers to a man who's scored nearly 6,000 test runs. A century on debut was all he could ask for, but this skipper isn't satisfied until he's got his money's worth.
He's got to get 123 because we've got a lottery on how many runs he was going to get in the first match, and I've got 123. But the danger is Norman, the umpire, has got 106, so anything that hits his pads, if he's on 106, he'll be out.
Some unexpected agility cut Richardson off in his prime. But in this sort of environment, he knows there's twice as much fun to be had off the field as on it. And after the stresses and strains of his career, who'd deny him his wine, women, and swan song?
And while Richie is relaxing in the Kent countryside, Angus Fraser, seen here dismissing him in last summer's Test series, is still working hard, amongst other things, putting together this month's video report.
It's now 8:45 on Thursday, the 9th of May. Slowly getting into Lourdes. This hasn't been a bad ride, actually. Been in the car for 55 minutes now. I'd say I'm 10 minutes away from Lourdes. Around the back of the pavilion and into my office.
Let me take you to the place where membership's a smiling face.
Now that is not a sight you want to see. And into the long room, actually a magnificent room. Pleasure to walk through it every day. Out through the gates and onto the grass. So you've been caught having a bacon butty in the...
I have to hold my hands up and say that is very true. I had a bacon butty this morning and a cup of tea, having previously done half an hour on the bike.
After a loosener, a net session, I think we're going to do some fielding on the outfield. Tea and biscuits, wait for the toss of the coin, hope we're batting, and then put your feet up.
This is my spot for the rest of the day.
Nice little pillow. Where's the pillow?
Just there. Lovely.
Again, we've filled Lourdes. This eagerly awaited game between Middlesex and Durham. Well, half an hour into the day, not going quite according to plan. 24 for 2. Poodian Ram Prakash are out.
Great disappointment to Mike Garting being not out at lunchtime.
How are you?
Means he has to have a very small lunch in the dressing room.
What did you have then when it came out?
More stuffing for you.
Good food. See it there?
Good food. Yeah,
happy rounds?
Nice.
You may wonder how opening batsmen get rid of their frustrations having been knocked over early on.
This is where you come to get your confidence back.
This is where our two go. They make hell of a din. So what's your theory here, Trigg? You're cutting them to the same size as your old pair. Which was short. Just want to have a look in my corner. Cat in the fetal position. Post-lunch.
Come on!
Well, Ricky, 3 wickets today. Not a bad start to the season.
Cheers.
Cheers. No, I'm interviewing you. You're supposed to be saying something.
Right. I'm very happy with it. Makes a change. Debut last year, bowled 3 overs. Number 25. So it's quite nice.
10 overs, 3 for 18. As usual, the bowlers are getting our batsmen out of the mire again. Right, what's the time?
27.
Quarter to 8.
Nearly, yeah.
Walked in the dressing room at 10 to 9 this morning. 10 runs, 1 for 23. Pretty ordinary day. See you later.
Thanks, Gus. Now, some players are dab hands at more than just cricket. Fiona Stevenson has tracked down 3 who are blessed with artistic as well as sporting talents.
Well, there are some lovely paintings in here. And cricket has been a favourite subject with artists for centuries. In fact, as a sport, it's unique in the way it's become part of the fabric of British art. So I decided to have a chat with 3 players who don't just confine their stroke play and artistry to the cricket field. Jack Russell is the doyen of cricketing artists. His love of cricket and the Gloucestershire countryside is manifested in many of his paintings on show in his gallery in Chipping Sodbury. So Jack, when did you first start on your artwork?
It was back in the sort of the late 80s, where around 1987 I started sketching, mainly at the cricket on wet summer days, stuck in the pavilion, bored, nothing to do except lose money at cards or watch TV. I got tired of that. And I started fiddling with pencils and a sketch pen. It's all come from there, really.
The historical military scenes which Jack so vividly captures inspired ex-Colonel Patrick Shervington to commission Jack's painting of his old regiment, the original of which hangs in the Tower of London.
This is High Holborn. My regiment, the Royal Regiment of Fusiliers, has this great big war memorial in the middle of the road, the old Prudential building there. And Jack came up a few days before Remembrance Day and started painting. And, of course, it caused all sorts of hullabaloo with the England wicketkeeper painting a picture in the middle of the City of London. So military scenes, cricketing scenes, both with similar sort of themes. He captures the focus, the core of the picture wonderfully well. He's a very talented artist.
When I'm painting a picture, all I'm thinking about is what's going to go on that canvas. And everything else seems to disappear out of my life, and I just focus in on that. So it's great therapy mentally for me. But keeping wickets a little bit like that, you know, you need to focus in, and it's you against catching that ball. So maybe the two are linked a little bit, and I find it quite easy just to wrap myself up in a painting and not come out of it for a few hours or even a few days.
J.
Jack wasn't the only artist in last winter's touring party. Lancashire's Peter Martin has taken a leaf out of Jack's book and now sells his prints in the Lancashire Club shop. But as the club sponsors found out, he doesn't limit his art to canvas.
Well, Peter, you've certainly made it big at the NYMEX headquarters. How does it feel having your work on such public display?
Not sure. I keep forgetting it's here, to be honest, because I never see it. But it's about a year since I saw it the last, and it's, you know, I'm proud of it. I quite like it. I was sort of dead set going to college and things like that, but cricket came along and I had a gutful of school, so I just decided not to bother. I really enjoy doing it, and you know, with it's moved alongside cricket, and it's, you know, been reasonably successful so far. So hopefully, if I can, you know, continue to do well at cricket, then, you know, the art might sort of go alongside.
What about portraits? Have you ever done any portraits?
Yep, here's one here.
Right.
I did one of Jack just the other day.
All right.
I just took a photograph of him when we were in Pakistan, and he actually did a picture of me on the plane when he wouldn't give it to me, so I might try and trade this one for it, see if he likes it.
Sussex player Martin Spate developed his artistic and cricketing skills in the idyllic surroundings of Hurst Pierpoint College. His old coach, Derek Semmons, has since been making use of this old boy's free-flowing brush.
The painting he did of this North Field, we still have a lot of prints left, actually. And the ones we sell, so much goes to Martin and so much goes to the next tour, which is great.
Martin's old school is not the only place that appreciates his art. Across the road from the county ground in Hove, the Cricketer's Pub is where Martin's work was first discovered.
So, Martin, how did your paintings end up in a pub?
Well, I had an exhibition here a couple of years ago, and the pub asked if they could keep a few just for the hall, and these are the remaining two or three that are left. It's something that I've always done as a relaxation. It's amazing. People sort of say, you know, do you do it for money, do you do it for this or whatever? But I've only really ever done it to enjoy it and to relax from the stress of playing cricket day in, day out.
So I believe Christopher Martin Jenkins had a part to play in establishing you as an artist.
That's right. Robin Smith had scored 100 here, and we were in the pub afterwards, and Christopher Martin Jenkins said, if you get 100 tomorrow, I'll mention it in the Telegraph report.
And you've even brought a book out of your paintings.
That's right. Last June, July, I brought out this book with the local publishers, and it seems to have gone pretty well over the last year.
Lovely. What kind of stuff have you got in there?
Well, it's a collection of 54 of my paintings, mainly cricket, associated with the press cuttings I've had, based on my work over the last 10 years.
Nah, not really. It's one of Jack's. But who knows, a little bit of practice. What kind of an artist are you, David?
I don't know what you mean, Fifi. Anyway, it's time now for our one and only round of Odd Man Out on Gower's Cricket Monthly. Can you spot the odd one out of these Test cricketers? Gordon Greenidge, Clive Rice, Malcolm Marshall, and Mike Dennis. Here to reveal all is Dougie Donnelly.
Well, the answer, as you know, David, is Mike Dennis. The other three all played for Scotland. Mike never played for Scotland as a professional. He only captained England. So what about cricket north of the border? There are those who will say that Scotland is to cricket what Saudi Arabia is to downhill skiing, but that's very unfair. The game's hugely popular here. I'm told there are more people play cricket in Scotland than play rugby. And the game's very well served too, with a magazine, The Scottish Cricketer, and a very glossy and very comprehensive 200-page Scottish cricket handbook. But the real secret, of course, is the weather. Those endless, golden summer days. Scotland's amateurs, it must be admitted, have always struggled against county opposition in the one-day competitions. Just 2 wins in 59 Benson and Hedges Cup matches, and none at all in 13 NatWest campaigns. Opening batsman Ian became Scotland's most capped player when he won his 91st at Headingley last month, knows how tough it is for weekend club cricketers to compete against professionals.
You've got to believe in yourself, and you've got to back yourself. It doesn't matter who you're coming up against, you've got to believe that you can do it. And I think if we can develop that inner side, we're only going to improve.
And yet I suppose there will always be critics who will say that Scotland really shouldn't be taking on the likes of Yorkshire.
Well, I disagree with that, because I think that's the only way we're going to improve, is to take on so-called better opposition. And it's going to make us see what we've actually got to do, you know, to get to a high standard.
These are exciting times for Scottish cricket. In July, they will expect to do well in the inaugural European Championship in Denmark. Even more significantly, next year's Mini World Cup, or ICC Associate Members Cup, to give it its proper title, gives Scotland two major opportunities to move on to a different level. If they can finish among the top four Commonwealth countries, they will return to Malaysia for the 1998 Commonwealth Games. A top three finish will mean that Scotland will really make the big time, with a place at the next World Cup in England in 1999. Jim Love, the former Yorkshire batsman, is the man with the responsibility for making the most of these opportunities. He is Scotland's director of cricket and was encouraged by the level of interest in the sport north of the border.
I was quite surprised at the fact that there are quite a lot of Scottish people who enjoy their cricket. There's a sort of hard core of support, almost like there is in Yorkshire, who enjoy their cricket, who travel around and play cricket, watch cricket. I was quite surprised at the interest, to be honest. I didn't think there'd be as much interest as there was. Mm. What we've tried to do now, or what we're trying to do recently, is encourage the youngsters and bring the youngsters on. And that's another story, really, but that's what we're trying to do.
But those youngsters, of course, have plenty of sporting alternatives to consider. In Edinburgh alone, there's top-class tennis, two Premier Division football clubs, Hibs and Hearts, the home of Scottish rugby at Murrayfield, and the longest artificial ski slope in Europe. But the city's cricket lovers still turned out in force for the Benson and Hedges match with Worcestershire last week. Thousands of them play the game every weekend.
You only have to get out there on a Saturday. Anywhere in Scotland, just about, apart from the Highlands, obviously, where there isn't enough flat ground anyway. But I mean, if you went to Aberdeenshire, you'd find five grades of cricket just in Aberdeenshire. And so there's a terrific enthusiasm. And one of the qualities about Scottish cricket to me is that the enthusiasm is so sky high. If they play cricket, they play it with real enthusiasm, you know.
17-year-old John Blaine is possibly the first ever Scottish teenager to give up a possible career in professional football in order to play cricket.
I was actually with Falkirk for 3 years. I left him. I felt I might not have made the top, and I was told by a lot of people that I could have made the top at cricket. I still can, so I felt, you know, I had a lot better talent at cricket than in football.
But the big question remains, can Scotland ever genuinely expect to beat full-time professional opposition?
No, I think you've got a problem there, and the only way you do that by having one or two overseas players. But on the other hand, if you can come somewhere near to it and it helps develop cricket in Scotland, and then you might produce a few players who might go on to play for England, you've had one or two already, then that would be good for the game.
You think of Durham, the latest recruit to the County Championship. 30 years they've been trying to get there, and it's cost them millions of pounds, literally. And I don't see the advantage to Scottish cricket in trying to do that. It is an amateur game. I think it will remain largely an amateur game. And the route to go is on the international stage rather than try and compete with the professional counties.
But if all this current optimism proves justified, you can be sure that the Tartan Army will be back in 1999 to play in the World Cup.
And while Scotland fell bravely in the B&H once again, India began their tour with plenty of runs and a couple of wickets. On Sunday they beat Middlesex at Lord's, but today at Northampton, despite another 88 from Sachin Tendulkar, the home side won on faster run rate. Now, with the rest of the latest news and scores, here's Simon Hughes.
Warwickshire are not slow on the uptake when it comes to acquiring exciting foreign talent, and like Lara and Donald before him, Sean Pollock made an immediate impact. Another with the next. Then another with his hat-trick ball. And incredibly, another to give him an amazing 4-in-4. The first time that feat's been done in England since 1972. Seamers are in charge at Chesterfield too, Lancashire's Mike Watkinson taking five Derbyshire wickets, though he couldn't have done it without the help of a horizontal Mike Atherton. Ah, winning. I remember that. The bowling of Gloucestershire batsman Tim Hancock may look inviting, but it lured Hampshire to defeat at Bristol, Winston Benjamin getting the elevation, but not the distance. Gives the West countrymen something to toast at last. And the vim and vigour of Michael Bevan hauled Yorkshire to victory at Worcester. Finally, people in the Broad Acres are waking up to the value of overseas players, though Dickie Bird didn't look too impressed. Perhaps he had a premonition about the draw, which lumbers his county with a daunting trip to the Oval, while Gloucester also have a long and potentially hazardous journey to Old Trafford. You can see highlights of the Lancashire-Gloucestershire match on BBC television on May the 28th. Meanwhile, in the Britannic Assurance County Championship, a change of leadership seems to have galvanised both Leicester and Yorkshire, who are only a point apart at the top. Last year's champions Warwickshire are 10th. Yesterday, Devon Malcolm defied the cold and the Politburo to take 6 wickets in Derbyshire's win, but he was upstaged by Lancashire's Peter Martin, who recorded a career-best 7 for 50. Essex fell into Min Patel's web at Ilford, Kent winning by an innings. Hampshire's wily medium pacers strangled the Warwickshire middle order at Edgbaston, over ambition ending Trevor Penny's determined innings of 73. The lower order fought gamely to save the match, and Keith Piper only succumbed to the acrobatics of Giles White. In the AXA Equity and Law League, a clutch of counties are level on 8 points, though not everyone has played 3 games. Traditional one-day specialists Lancashire are always there or thereabouts, like the bowling of Kent all-rounder Mark Elam. But it was with the Willow that the chunky son of Alan caught the eye of the selectors, including those belonging to an influential member of the opposition on the lookout for smash-and-grab artists. Atherton, irked by suggestions that his batting is only fit for Test cricket, decided on a bit of Elam-style savagery himself as Lancashire coasted to victory. A third member of England's Texaco squad, Neil Smith, emphasised his development with a maiden century in the Sunday League, reached with unfamiliar subtlety, another lad treading in his father's footsteps. To Stuart Law, centuries are like London buses. No worries, there'll be another one along in a minute. He scored 3 in 4 days for Essex, pummeling county bowlers to all parts, just as the England cabinet were getting together for their first reshuffle.
And shock news today for Chairman Ray Illingworth is that he may be facing disciplinary action. Following complaints by Derbyshire over comments made about Devon Malcolm in extracts from a new book serialised in a newspaper this morning, the TCB are considering the matter. And that's it for this month. Don't forget you can watch all this year's Test cricket live here on the BBC and, of course, highlights of the One Day Internationals. I'll be back again on June the 17th with the next Gower's Cricket Monthly, by which time I sincerely hope it'll be a tad more summery. Till then, bye-bye.